Welcome to EntreProgrammers Podcast, the podcast for developpreneurs, the podcast where you get to be a fly on the wall listening to real conversations of three developers trying to tackle the challenges they face as entrepreneurs.
Hey, what's up? John Sonmez here. Just want to take a second to thank one of the sponsors for this episode of EntreProgrammers, DigitalOcean. So I've talked about DigitalOcean a lot before on the show, and that's because they're just such an awesome company. I use them to host all of my websites, basically simpleprogrammer.com, which gets around 200,000 page views a month, runs on there super smooth. Get Up and Code runs on there. The EntreProgrammers podcast that you're listening to right now, we use DigitalOcean for that. I use it for just about everything, and it's such a good deal. You know, as far as hosting goes, right, if you're going to run your own Linux server and do your own web hosting at $5 a month, which is the starting plan for DigitalOcean, you just really can't beat that. It's crazy. And when you do need something super powerful, DigitalOcean comes through for you as well, and it's so easy to scale up to that. I started out on Simple Programmer with a $10 a month box, and I was even able with that to get 100,000 page views a month without much of a problem. But when I wanted to scale up, all I had to do was bring the server down, expand the size, go up to the higher size droplet, and bam, I was up there, and I've expanded it a couple of times since then. So DigitalOcean, definitely awesome company. I would definitely recommend that you check it out if you have any idea of creating a website online, or you want to have your own Linux server to be able to do whatever it is that you want to do, some development or put out a production app. Just a ton of great things that you can do with DigitalOcean. Go to DigitalOcean.com and use the code EntreProgrammers to get $10 credit. So DigitalOcean.com, EntreProgrammers is your code, and you get $10 credit, good for basically 2 months at a $5 box, so you can check it out. Hey, what's up? John Sonmez here. Just wanted to tell you about NIRD. You can find them at nird.us. And what NIRD is Ruby on Rails managed hosting. It's a pretty cool service because what they basically do is they can manage your entire Ruby on Rails application, do all kinds of neat stuff like configure the services that you need, do continuous deployment, DNS, and SSL management. They'll also migrate all your data from your old host, so it makes it super easy to sign up with them. They update your security on your application, have the latest security patches, and then they also provide 2 hours a month of application bug fixes, so that's pretty dang awesome. Anyway, so check them out. You can go to nird.us, and when you sign up, you're going to get a referral code. You're going to basically get a $100 discount if you use this offer, so check it out. It's totally worth it, and let us know what you think of it. You can find the link there to sign up if you just go to nird.us/manage-rails-hosting. That's nird.us/manage-rails-hosting, and then just put into the contact form freelancer and you'll get that discount code. Hope you check it out and hope you enjoy it, and thanks for listening.
All right, we are live, episode 100.
Wow, no pressure.
Amazing. At episode 104, it'll be 2 years worth of podcasts, but episode 100 is pretty amazing still.
And now on my YouTube, for everyone who's watching and wondering what the heck is going on, I started getting these comments now. I'm getting these emails with links.
Oh, no.
You look like the guy from Walking Dead.
Wow. Nice. What prompted the shaving?
I don't know. I was looking for a change.
Okay.
So shave the hair and get rid of the glasses.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'd usually wear contacts a lot of the time, but I guess not usually on Friday morning, so maybe that's why. Yeah, so anyway.
Yep.
How are you guys doing?
I'm about to have a panic attack and roll up and die. This happens to me every time before a presentation, and I'm doing my JS Remote Conf presentation 2.5 hours from now. So that's where Chuck is at the moment, running that.
Okay.
So I'm probably not going to stay on this call very long because I want to be able to practice my talk at least one more time and then have time to curl up and cry for a while before I actually get on and do it. I know it's weird. It's a lot less pressure being remote than it is being live, but it's still, when it comes down to it, it's still incredibly stressful for me. It's not just the travel and everything that causes the stress. It's the actual preparation for a talk. I mean, you can ask me a question about a subject that I'm familiar with, and I can talk for hours on end. But if you want me to condense some knowledge into something really meaningful in a short period of time, like 40 minutes or so, it's tremendously difficult for me to do that. I'm not a concise person. So coming up with the right things to say in a small amount of time is always very difficult for me, and it always makes me very nervous.
Yeah. I totally agree. It's, you know, the funny thing is, it's not necessarily the most optimal way anyway.
Right.
Like, I started getting, on my YouTube channel, sometimes I get comments from people like, oh, 5 minutes and he still is on the same point, or like, you know, repeated. And I actually did a video just recently talking about why I do that, which is the fact that when you reinforce that works better. Like, people learn better. So usually if I'm talking about a point, I'll say the same thing three times, but I'll say it in three different ways using different language.
Yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately, like when we go to conferences and we speak at them, I mean, most of the time, even
having an amazing time in terms of ticket sales, which is pretty awesome.
All came in at the end there. That's crazy.
Yeah, apparently. I watched a few sessions yesterday, and there were, I think, 80 to 100 people on in the three sessions that I watched yesterday. And this morning, just before jumping on this call, I checked in and saw what was going on, and there were 143 people watching. So huge bump from yesterday.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm hoping there's that most of those 143, if not more, stick around for my session coming up.
Yeah. If you think about it, like, Chuck must have been sweating it.
Yeah.
Because up till yesterday, he had only like $3,000 in sales for this whole event that which isn't a lot for this event. So, yeah. So.
It all came in at the last minute.
Yeah.
So I've been monitoring my metrics for Watch Me Code on Baremetrics, and the more I dig into these numbers and really study them, the more I absolutely love Baremetrics. I think we need to reach out to them and see if they'll sponsor the show at some point, if we ever lose any of our sponsors. But I'm looking at what I've got going now. And a few of the important metrics are improving. My monthly recurring revenue is up 1.8% for the last 30 days. My revenue churn and also my user churn are both going down, which is good.
Nice.
My user churn is down from 12.6 to 11.9, which is a 5.6% drop, which is really nice. I've also had a lot less cancellations in the last 30 days. I'm down 15% on my cancellations. But then, oddly enough, my failed charges have jumped by 8.5%.
I wonder if that's due to credit cards being maxed out.
Yeah, I'm guessing it is. There's a lot of failed credit card payments going on here. Now, I think my email saying, hey, your payment failed, is helping out, though, because I'm looking at the trends for the history of the unresolved charges, and I'm seeing that there are good groupings of resolved failed payments, people that went back in and fixed their payment. So it's based on just this one front page, it's about 30, maybe 40% of the failed charges are being resolved.
Nice.
Yeah, there's a fair group that is still unresolved, but I think for the most part, people are getting it taken care of. Which is nice. It'll be good to watch this run for another month and see how these numbers really pan out.
Yeah,
once, and especially once we get past the little weird, the weirdness, and you can
January.
Get a quarter's worth of perspective on it, or two quarters.
And I do know that the failed charges jump up and down a lot anyways. If I look at the complete history, I can see that it jumps up to 15%, back down to 5%, up to 12%, down to 7%, up to... So, I mean, it jumps up and down a lot to begin with, but I think it tends to go up when I have those large sales that bring in a lot of people, which makes sense. Mm-hmm. You have a lot of new subscribers, and those new subscribers are probably going to be a little unstable for a while. So I was talking with a guy here in town last week, I think. I didn't mention this last week. I think I just forgot about it. But on the subject of that automatic customer book, he was the guy that recommended to me.
Oh, yeah.
And I was talking with him about the things that I've been doing based on the metrics I'm seeing in Baremetrics. And he asked the question of, would it make sense for me to have an annual subscription, which is something that clearly we've thought a lot.
Yeah.
And I've once thought or twice. About doing a lot, but never actually pulled the trigger. And I'm thinking that I might actually do that fairly soon. I don't know how soon because of other things I have going on and other things that I need to get fixed first. But in looking at my lifetime value and the average number of months that a customer sticks around, I think a yearly subscription would be beneficial for me because the average subscriber is sticking around for 6 or 8 months. And if I can get them to pay a year instead of monthly, that would be a pretty big boost to the overall income. The thing that really concerns me there is in part of what I'm reading in that automatic customer book is having to deal with the one lump sums versus the monthly recurring revenue.
Mm-hmm.
I have to get better at accounting and about paying myself out of my bank accounts on a regular basis with a regular set amount of income if I'm going to do that. Because if I get 50 customers that sign up for the 1 year and I bring in $5,000, well, that's that's a nice chunk of money up front, but if I take that $5,000 out of my bank right away and use it to pay off my credit cards or whatever, well, there's less money that I'm going to have per month because it was all one-time upfront charges.
Well, so that's a misnomer that people have about the annual subscriptions because I've heard multiple people talking about this.
Okay.
It happens when you first do the sale, of course.
Right.
It's a one-time event, and then there'll be a slow curve, but eventually it's just like product sales, right? It'll be continual. Mm-hmm. So, even though it seems like it's coming in spurts, you'll be continually adding new subscribers to annual at the same rate. It's not going to be.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
So eventually it'll
smooth. Yeah.
Yeah, it'll be kind of weird for a while, though. I think.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's not like I'm going to do a one-time. Buy a yearly subscription and then stop the yearly subscription after that. People will continue to sign up at yearly subscription at a fairly regular rate. And
yep. Right.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Mm-hmm. If you're going to do this, I think it would make sense to... Well, two quick thoughts. So, first of all, if you're going to do this, definitely I think it would make sense to test your sales page. Right. It might make more sense to do this after you've already converted them. Because you're adding, it's possible that the discounted rate of getting a full year at once will bump your conversions, but it could also, putting two choices in front of them could also hurt your conversions. So,
yeah, my plan was to take the approach of $14 a month for the sales page, but then give them don't put side by side monthly versus annual. Do more of the click here to get monthly or annual. Like show them here's the annual price. Oh, you want to pay monthly? Well, click here for that option instead.
Mm-hmm.
Like with Baremetrics, when I signed up with them, they defaulted to I don't remember which. They defaulted to either monthly or I think they defaulted to monthly. But so, then I chose the option to go annual because there was the big, you know, save, get 2 months free or whatever. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think what I don't like is when Salesforce does this, where they advertise the monthly price. They advertise a monthly price, which is the annual price divided by 12.
Yeah, yeah.
And then they hit you with a lump sum.
Yep.
They hit you with the lump sum all at once when you buy it.
Right.
That stinks.
Now, yeah, I don't like that either. I think I would probably go the, you know, $14 a month and then give them the nice big text that says get 2 months free when you pay annually.
Yeah. So my other thought on that is it would be good. I don't know how you do this, but there's got to be a way to dig into your numbers, because that average, the average of 6 to 8 months is misleading.
Is it?
Yes. I think because what you have, think of it's an 80-20 curve. You've got some people who have been on there for 2 years and some people who could cancel after a month.
Right.
So what you have to watch is that you're not like siphoning off the people that have been on there for 2 years and are paying you for 12 months. You don't want to, like, you could end up in a situation where you've taken all of your best customers and just given them a discount, and then everybody else who's less interested and is going to cancel sooner isn't going to upgrade anyway.
True.
So
yeah,
I don't know if how you figure that out, but it would be good to get a better idea of the actual distribution of subscription lengths versus the average.
Hmm.
Yeah, because I guess there would be a difference between 80% of people subscribe for 2 years and 20% 1 month, and that averages out to 6 months. I don't know if it does, but...
Yeah.
Versus 50% subscribe for 9 months and 50% subscribe for 3 months.
Right? Yeah.
Right, so...
That's interesting.
Yeah. So, So I think it's worth looking into. The whole annual thing is interesting because it's really beneficial to a lot of SaaS companies because they are paying, like, they're in this cash burn mode where they are planning to overspend their revenue by, you know, large multiples for several years.
Right.
And so they're just essentially pulling revenue forward, and that's a win for them because they can dump it back into paid advertising. So you just have to make sure that, you know, that scenario, because you're not paying for advertising, so
right. The
equation looks a little different for you.
True.
Yeah. I mean, most likely, though, I mean, just from your data, it probably seems like it's not at the worst it's going to be even, but it shouldn't hurt you.
Yeah.
Right. I can always try it out and then yank the annuals out of there if it is screwing me over.
I think maybe just the thing to look at would be to look at, do an export of all of your data and look at when people actually signed up.
Right.
And maybe group them by month or something and just kind of get a sense for how that actually, you know, what the distribution looks like.
Yeah. I wonder if I can get the Baremetrics people to give me that
report. Yeah, that would be interesting to ask.
That would be a really good report to have, and I don't see that anywhere in the metrics that they show.
That's one of the things Perry talks a lot about in the 80-20 stuff is average is almost always, like, if you're looking at average, it's almost always going to give you the wrong information.
Yeah,
right.
Because nobody's average. True. So it's like you're asking and answering the wrong questions if you're talking about averages usually.
Yeah, it depends on what you're asking and why.
Yeah.
But I see your point in needing to understand that curve. If I don't have a standard bell curve, then it certainly is going to screw me. If I have, like, an inverse bell where the majority are on the low end or the high end and there's nobody in the middle, then it probably is going to screw me.
Yeah. If you can plot it on you're exactly right. That's what if you can plot it and see if it's a bell curve or not, that's going to tell you the answer most likely. So.
Okay, I'll have to do that. I think I can get some exports out of this and run it through a spreadsheet, and then I'll probably end up contacting Baremetrics to see what they can do about that. If they have plans to do that or can add something like that, it would be nice. I already contacted them just last night. I haven't heard back yet. But Baremetrics has this open startup program. If you hit baremetrics.com/open, you'll see a dozen or so companies that have their metrics completely open to the public. Mm. They anonymize data so that you can't see real names, but it shows actual monthly recurring revenue and user churn and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, it's really cool. So I emailed them last night asking to get Watch Me Code added into that, because I talk about my income and my churn and everything already on the podcast, so why not just open it up for anybody that wants to go look? And it might even help me out in some cases, but it'll certainly help other people out, because I get a fairly regular number of questions from people on Twitter or email or whatnot asking about my subscriber count and income and whatnot, and I'm completely open about all of this because I want to help other people out.
Yeah. Wow. It would be nice if I would love something like this for websites too.
Yeah.
You know, like right now one of the things I'm working on is this guest posting thing, and I'm trying to figure out, like, if I go, you know, work my butt off and get some good posts written for entrepreneur.com, what kind of referral traffic am I going to get from that? Like, is it going to be crickets, or am I going to get, you know, decent traffic, or is it mainly a SEO play?
Right. I mean,
I'm actually contacting some people that have written posts and trying to find out from them.
Yep. And that would be nice to have some real information about that kind of stuff.
Yep. It's kind of like, for me, it's nice because I've got, you know, I have worked with enough clients that I've started to see, I have access to a bunch of accounts that I can kind of look at and, you know, start to get a feel for how much traffic, like when your Alexa rank is 50,000, like what kind of, you know, what ballpark are you in terms of traffic, that kind of stuff.
Wow, that's crazy. Looking at that data, just looking at the Baremetrics page, because Baremetrics is doing 40K MRR.
Right.
They only have 451 customers.
Yep.
And if you look at it, their biggest customer is, or at least on their, well, probably their biggest one is Buffer. And they're doing 715K MRR.
Right.
So Baremetrics probably has a large chunk of their revenue coming from the one customer Buffer.
Mm-hmm. Probably.
Yep.
Yep.
And ConvertKit would be probably on there too.
Yeah, but which is pretty amazing. I was pretty surprised to see the MRR for ConvertKit at over 100,000.
That's Nathan Berry's thing, right?
Yeah, it is.
Yep. Yeah,
I knew he was doing well. I was on his email list for a while, and I saw him go through the whole rebranding and rebuilding and refocusing of that a while back, and it's amazing.
Rob, what have you done for us lately? Just kidding.
The thing that really blew up ConvertKit though was he got in the Pat Flynn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He got in like Flynn.
What I really like about that is that he was kind of doing things the hipster bootstrapping kind of way for a long time with the content marketing and stuff. And basically he was like, oh, I need to do direct sales.
Yep.
Yeah.
And he did direct sales. And boom. I mean, he's just been literally just reaching out one-on-one to people for a year and a half. And I'm seeing
his stuff more and more all over the place. I think even Baremetrics uses ConvertKit for their blog and their email list sign-up and everything. So he's definitely doing some good work there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he might have been working with Brian Harris too, because Brian wrote that post a while back about how you can, there's like this open source or this source code search engine that will search the web for source code, and so you could type in the Infusionsoft URL for the forms, and you could see a list of 25,000 websites that had Infusionsoft forms on them. And I'm pretty sure that Nathan has been using that and going through and reaching out individually to websites.
Nice.
Yep.
Oh, I'm wrong about Baremetrics. In fact, there's a problem in their pricing model. What's their highest pricing tier is $250 a month for 200,000 MRR or less.
Yeah, but then if you can go beyond that when you have higher levels. There's the whole enterprise contact us thing.
I don't see it.
Really?
I'm looking at their pricing. No, they need to have...
it was there. I swear it was there.
They need to have a way for people to give them more money.
Need a larger plan? Send us an email right below the list of plans.
Oh, but they don't have anyone that's... I mean, at least it doesn't have anything above two... Buffer is below 200,000 MRR.
So yeah, Buffer's, but this is only for the 15 companies that have the open dashboard. They have they certainly have more companies than that at 451 customers.
But what I'm saying is that if Buffer's making like 170,000 MRR,
mm-hmm. and they're only paying $250 a month.
Yeah.
But Buffer is hitting 715,000 a month.
You're right. Oh, sorry. Yeah, you're right. You're right. 715,000. Okay, so they're paying probably more.
They're probably paying a lot more.
Yeah.
But and I'm sure there's other companies that are in the pretty good price ranges as well. But
yeah, that's interesting to see that data though.
Yeah.
But it also is interesting to see that you don't need that many customers. I mean,
if you've got a high priced product.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, Baremetrics has hardly any more customers than I do, but they have literally more than 10 times the monthly recurring revenue. They've got like 40 more customers than me. But I don't think I can charge $250 a month for Watch Me Code.
Well,
speaking of email marketing, back to that for a moment. Super duper excited about the visual designer from Drip. Did you guys see those emails?
Oh yeah, yep.
That's going to be amazing.
I didn't see. Did he officially release it yet?
He sent out the first email of his launch sequence. It was like it was literally just one screenshot of a little circle of part of a branching logic piece.
And
said, coming soon in 2 weeks, the revolutionize the way you communicate with your customers or something like that, or blow the lid off the way you communicate.
I must not be on that list.
Really?
Yeah, I'm on, like, Rob sent me a list of, sent an announcement to me on what appeared to be some kind of private list. So
that might be why you're not on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because you've already got this, don't you?
Yeah, I've got it. Yep. Nice. Maybe he segmented people out who didn't have it yet.
Probably.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Would be the
it
right
is
thing
pretty
to do.
Sweet. It is pretty sweet.
So yeah, that's about it for me. I've spent the whole week finishing up this presentation and then looking at Baremetrics. I've turned off all of the emails that I get from Watch Me Code directly, so I no longer see when payments are successful or when payments fail. Now I just see the daily Baremetrics email, and then I go look at my Baremetrics dashboard on a fairly regular basis. Every now and then I still log in and check the Watch Me Code site to see how things are going, because I still have about 105 customers that are on PayPal, which is really starting to get me nuts. I've got...
Wow.
Yeah. I'm seriously considering putting some incentive in place, like giving people a free month or something if they will switch from PayPal over to credit card, because PayPal just continuously wreaks havoc on Watch Me Code. I've got one customer right now. I just emailed him today or responded to him today. He can't see any of the videos because his account got put to expired status. So I reactivated his account so he could get in and watch things, but this is essentially caused by PayPal. Back in November, PayPal stopped his payments. He didn't tell them to; they just stopped it. And that happens at least 3 or 4 times a month. I'll have several people a month that just the PayPal decides to stop paying.
What? How about the? How about when that happens? Can you just say, "Hey, I'm not supporting this anymore. Here's how you can."
Yeah, that's what I do.
Okay. Great.
When that happens and people email me, I say, hey, sorry, this is an ongoing problem. I don't support PayPal anymore. Here's how you switch to credit card I'll put you back on the discounted plan that you were on. Just let me know, blah, blah, blah. So this guy did that. He went and changed his subscription over to credit card in back in November. Like a day or two after he changed his subscription, PayPal charged him anyways. And the Restrict Content Pro system, like, freaked out. It didn't know what to do with that. So it put him back in the PayPal payment group.
Oh,
even though he did not, even though he no longer had an active subscription with PayPal, but he now has an active subscription with Stripe, and the Watch Me Code website doesn't know about it because PayPal sent the information over and said, "Hey, he's got a subscription with us." So there's this giant disconnect between his account, what used to be PayPal subscription and no longer is, and what actually is his subscription on Stripe. And the only way for me to fix this is for him, is for me to go in and manually cancel his Stripe account, which will cancel his Watch Me Code account, and then for him to resubscribe and me to put him back on the discounted plan again.
Wow.
So it's tremendously frustrating, and it's I like to blame PayPal because I hate PayPal for subscriptions, but really it's also partially the Restrict Content Pro system for assuming that PayPal was the authority when PayPal said it was, and in reality Stripe was the authority, and the Restrict Content Pro system is essentially ignoring the Stripe webhooks that are being sent to it, saying, "I don't know what this payment is for, I'm just going to ignore it."
Well, hey, when Elon Musk says jump, you ask how high, right?
Something like that.
Oh, literally how high.
So yeah, that's man, PayPal, freaking hate those. I mean, they're fine for individual purchases. I still do PayPal for the bundle sales, and I generally don't have any problems with that. Every now and then, I'll have somebody contest a payment, but that's pretty rare, pretty few and far between. I mean, for the 40,000 that I brought in last year, or 30,000 that I brought in last year from bundle sales, you know, I maybe had a few hundred people contest the purchase through PayPal. So it wasn't a huge deal on that end. It's just the what they do to subscriptions is nightmarish at best.
Yeah, even just finding your subscriptions.
Oh yeah, it's impossible. I literally don't know how to tell people how to find it. I have people emailing me saying, "Hey, I'm still getting charged by PayPal," or "Hey, I want to update my subscription in PayPal." And my response is, "I'm sorry, I honestly don't know how to find your subscription in PayPal. Try Googling PayPal subscription page and see if you can find it." Because it's impossible to find. I spent an hour looking one day, clicking through links on the PayPal website, and I couldn't find it.
Yeah. Stripe is adding ACH. I don't know if you guys saw that.
Oh, nice. Oh.
Yep.
Cool.
That'll be nice.
In fact,
nice.
They may have added it. I think it's in the API.
Okay.
So we should start seeing that with other things. Like maybe DPD will start supporting Stripe.
That would be great, because then I could get my... then I could get my coaching students to use that because I'm paying credit card fees on those.
Oh, jeez, nice. Yeah.
It would be nice to not have to do that.
Seriously, I had a situation in December where I needed my paycheck from my client faster than they were going to get it to me faster than my bank was going to be able to process the deposit.
Yeah.
So instead of him handing me a check and me doing the deposit like I always do, I had him pay through credit card using Stripe and going through my Harvest account. And the credit card fee, it was like a $4,500
check.
And the credit card fee was like almost $200.
Yep. Yeah.
It was insane.
Yeah. Yeah, the last month, Wes and I have been trying to get money across the border. I went through this last year, you guys remember?
Yeah.
So last year we had this it was like around $10,000 from our Black Friday sale. And I was seriously contemplating driving to the border and meeting him with like a brown paper bag because it was so painful. Last year we were able to get the international bank transfer to work.
Right.
This year, for some reason, using the exact same information, it keeps getting rejected. And yeah, so we've tried it several times now, and I'm thinking. So he told me he opened up a U.S. bank account. So okay. I'm hoping that he can transfer money from his Canadian bank account to his U.S. bank account, and then just cut me a check through like electronic bill pay. Because yeah, it's just a nightmare, and it would be like it's like around $3,000, so it would be the it would be at least $100 on the PayPal fees because it's like right around 3%.
Yeah.
But ACH is great. Yeah, I use that through QuickBooks whenever I can.
Yep. That
it's
would
like
be
a 50
nice.
Cents 50 cent transaction fee instead of $300.
Yeah.
That would be nice, and that would help people get off of PayPal as well. If people could do that directly for various payments.
Yep. PayPal's kind of weird. There's this fuzzy, like, I don't quite understand the send money to, have you guys seen the send money to family and friends versus the pay for goods and services? Like, I'm never sure.
The difference is when you send money to family and friends, you pay the fees.
Yeah.
When you pay for goods and services, the seller pays the fees. So I pay Eric, our editor. Hi, Eric. I pay him using the pay for goods and services because PayPal gets really uptight when you send people money over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. They assume that you're trying to cheat them out of fees because it's cheaper when you do the pay friends and family.
Mm-hmm.
So I send it to Eric using the pay for goods and services, and it's costing him far more in fees than it should. And so last month, for the month of January, I started sending him a little extra to cover the cost of those fees.
Yeah. Yeah, for me, there's like some gray areas. Like there's when I do my Sublime giveaways, right? I'm sending somebody basically a prize. And it's not like I'm certainly not paying them for anything.
Right.
So I think the friends and family option is right there. And yeah, I think that you don't get any fees unless it's over a certain amount.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
Yeah, well, no, you get fees. I just use the send friends and family. I never use the other one. And on a $30, I still pay 15 cents, so it's not.
That's not bad.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, it's not, but if you do, if you have business to business, there's no fee at all.
Yeah, I think that's what LeanPub uses.
Yeah.
For theirs. I need to look into that because
I think you need to have a business PayPal account for that to work though.
Right? Yeah. I couldn't understand what was involved in having a business PayPal account.
Me either. I was kind of nervous about looking into it because I didn't want to screw myself up and end up having things break and change and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've got mine set up on business. There's also Payments Premier Pro, which is I couldn't understand.
I couldn't understand from their documentation what the differences were.
Yeah.
It's really obtuse.
Very.
But at least their UI is flat now,
It's getting better slowly.
Well, what's funny is I have two different accounts, and when I log into the one that I use for my personal stuff, boom, completely different UI. It's like the crazy new UI.
Yeah.
My business account or the account that I use for business looks like a flat UI version of the old UI. So I don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, that may be style sheet caching on your browser.
Yeah, very possible. I'll have to control or command R.
Yep, have to open an incognito window. See if that helps.
See what that does to it. Josh, something you said reminded me. I read the book Dumbing Us Down finally.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was good. So
was it? Yeah, I haven't read it yet. I really want to.
Yeah.
That was John Taylor Gatto, right?
Yep, exactly. Yep. Yeah. So yeah, his he makes a pretty compelling case. So I'm going to be
nice.
Handing that book out to a lot of people that are opposed to homeschooling. So
yeah, Derick, I think John and I talked about this off air, but basically, you know who he is, John Taylor Gatto. He was named, I think it was National It was either New York State Teacher of the Year or National Teacher of the Year. And he stood up to accept his award at the awards banquet. And he said, the only reason that I'm here tonight is because I ignored everything you told me to do. I did everything you told me not to do. And I'm resigning.
Wow.
So he basically, like, screwed, you know.
Yeah.
He and he's gone on this crusade against public education ever since, and it's a pretty interesting book. It details the origins of the current public education system. So
yeah, the current factories.
Yes.
Yeah, it's real good. I think it's a good book to just like get people to understand why. Because I kept on having this issue when we went to my wife's family's house, my father-in-law's, like, you know, kept on, you need to medicate your child and put her in
school. Oh my gosh.
And I was like, you know, I was trying to explain to him, like, it's the system.
Yeah.
I mean, there's the educational aspect, but it's not just the educational aspect. It's like the system. I was trying to explain to him, like, even like it took me a long time to get quote free of the system, but I'm still not. My brain still works in the. It was trained in such a way to view false authorities like teachers and you know, which are not true authorities, and false groupings and rules and rules that don't really exist, and you know, things like that you kind of get trained to be a follower, like a to not use your brain so much. And I can't erase that from my brain. Like I can become more and more aware and free and at a conscious level realize that I'm operating to some degree within that system. But my goal for my daughter, I was trying to explain to him, was to not have really, you know, to have a much, I mean, obviously you're going to have some levels of control, but that society enforces on you, but to not ever have that mindset from the beginning. And
look into the unschooling movement.
Yeah.
Something that some of my friends have talked about in another number of other contexts, and I think it's very much in line with the way all three of us think about the education system.
Yeah. We did, so growing up, we did a bunch, I was homeschooled all the way through, K through 12. And we did a couple different approaches. My favorite approach, and the one that I'd love to see, I'd love to see actual like schools do this. It was really simple. It was basically like instead of having 8 or 10 different subjects that you're studying, it was reading, writing, and arithmetic. And we'd spend an hour or so on math every day, and then we'd spend an hour. We were supposed to like pick a book that was something that we were interested in. It was nonfiction, and we just basically, it was self-directed study, and you'd read, and then you'd have to write something critical about it. And you do that like every day. And it got you, like, it really made you think, and it gave you so much exposure to, for one thing, it didn't crush your desire to learn, because it harnessed it, because the stuff that we were reading wasn't, you know, it wasn't boring. It was stuff, and I was like, I mean, I started my ADD thing early on, and I was like, I would go on these kicks where I would read, like, there, I got on the kick where I was interested in the weasel family of animals. So I got like every book out of the library about the weasel family and read all of them.
Nice.
You know, and like I did that there. I could probably list 50 things that I did that about.
You studied the weasel family. You're obsessed about the weasel family, and then you grew up and became an internet marketer.
Yeah, there you go.
Coincidence?
I think. Yeah. So. Yeah. There you have it.
All right, I'm gonna drop off the call at this point. I want to go practice my talk again. So I just
go
want to be here for episode 100, which is pretty amazing. So I'll see you guys next week.
Good luck.
Thanks.
All right. See ya.
All right. Take care. But yeah, no, that's. I think you've got it exactly right. That makes the most sense. Because that's all you really need is the reading, writing, and arithmetic, essentially.
It's basically like what it taught me was basic logic, how to learn, and how to teach myself.
Yep.
And those are, I think, the most important skills. Like everything else is going to be a tool that you use and throw away. Things have gotten more and more disposable, you know, and like, I think it's absolutely ridiculous to spend time in school teaching you know, teaching kids how to use Microsoft Excel.
Right, exactly.
I mean, like, that's just the most absurd thing, because if you know how to pick something up, you get a job where you need that, well, you know what? 3 weeks and you'll have it.
Right, exactly.
We're very much like, my wife and I are very much about not, like, I think that people push their kids into stuff. I think it's good to push your kids, but they also push their kids into stuff really early. And when you do that before they're ready, what you do is you just expand the window of how long it takes them to master the skill. So, like,
that's a good point. Yeah.
You know, like, with our kids, we see this where, like, yeah, we could sit there and, like, try to get our 2 year old, you know, our 2 year old boy, to be, you know, have perfect handwriting. But, like, we just kind of waited till he was ready, and he just did it. Yeah. He just picked it up. Yeah, it was, like, a little bit later than other kids were starting to work on it, but he's, like, now ahead of where, like, he's way ahead of, for almost everything, he's way ahead of most kids his age, and we haven't pushed him into much of anything.
Yeah. Yeah, we've gone through the more of the painful process of, but the only things I'm really pushing on is reading and math, just because those are the two skills you can't learn on your own. Well, yeah. I mean, unless you're a genius, right? So
yeah, I mean, I taught myself to read.
Yeah, but so, you're a genius. I mean,
my mom read to us a lot.
Yeah.
And then I just started reading. I don't remember when or how. Like, I didn't learn, like, with phonics or anything. I was a terrible speller, though, because I was all sight reading. So we had to go back and do remedial phonics with me so that I could learn how to spell stuff. But
yeah, it's kind of interesting when we're looking at the homeschooling stuff, because part of, like, when we're trying to figure out where to live and stuff is kind of, we want to find the right community. And a lot of the homeschoolers, it falls into different camps, and very few of them line up with us. So lot of them is religious based. And while we're religious, that's not our primary motivation, is not. And I, you know, although I'm Christian, I don't really like fundamentalist Christians.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a crowd. There's a very hardcore fundamentalist crowd among homeschoolers. And then there's a smaller but equally hardcore crowd of extreme leftists.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's typically like the unschoolers. And I almost feel like, I mean, some of them, their heart is in the right place, but a lot of them are like, I just don't want to, I'm too lazy to teach my children anything. So I don't want to teach them anything. Or, you know, they'll figure it out on their own. We don't need to. And then, so the way that I define where we're at is like the entrepreneurial homeschoolers. Like,
yeah.
We just don't want a better education and not part of the system. And that's like, and there's very few of those. So
we're right now, we're kind of leaning towards doing private school.
Yeah.
And just cause I'm about 50-50 on it, homeschooling versus private schooling. What I'd actually really love would be a non-traditional private school, kind of like the Montessori thing.
Exactly.
But it tends to be the hard left type of crowd, and that's not really, that doesn't align with where we are. I'd love to see more non-traditional educational models. Pretty much it's like your choices are like a, you know, public school, a private version of public school, or do it yourself. And that's things.
So here's my thoughts I've been having lately.
Okay.
Want to join my commune? So I'm thinking about building a utopia.
Okay.
Right? So, so basically it'd be like, I'm going to find some land, you know, outside of a city. We're going to build these townhome, like, you know, that are all like facing each other in a circle, in a, like an octagon.
I'm not sure how much of this to take seriously.
I've actually been thinking about this. Like, I was just, you know, anyway. And then in the middle, there's a park, right?
Okay.
Like,
So it's like the whole thing is surrounded. So you don't have to worry about, you know, everyone, all the kids can go and play there.
Right.
And you don't have to worry about strangers or anything, right? Because the buildings are actually, it's like a courtyard almost. Like
Yeah.
Fences it all in.
Right.
And then you have in that same space, there'll be like a center building in there. Or somewhere like on that compound, compound, and there'll be like a co-working space where all the adult, like all the, this would be all for like entrepreneurs that are homeschooling their children. So you'd have the place there where you can like share ideas and work together in the office where you know it's right in the home but outside of the home, right? So it's right there. And then you'd have like homeschooling room, and then you'd have like the different parents can work together in homeschool or bring in even tutors and stuff. And so it'd all be, because it's like similar mindset, right? The same thing, internet business entrepreneurs, they want to homeschool their kids. They want to have their kids to have, you know, to be able to hang out with other kids that have the same kind of mindset and thing. And then also just to work together. So yeah, so that's my plan.
That actually sounds pretty cool. Because I mean that is the problem with homeschooling is like finding people. Well, it's a problem, especially a problem for people like us with the entrepreneurial mindset, because there are just not. I honestly don't know anyone near my that lives around me that is doing what you know anything like what I'm doing.
Right. Exactly. Yep.
Pretty much everybody that I talk to regularly is online because, you know, it's just not that kind of community.
Yeah. And when you filter it down further, when you're like, okay, and has young kids and is thinking about homeschooling or not traditional education, then it's like, you've got a smaller slice.
Yeah.
So if you could get all those people together in the same place, you know,
nice. If you can put that somewhere with Southern California's climate and no taxes, I'm in.
Well, yeah. So it'd probably be somewhere in, I'm thinking Texas, because Texas is a good place for like.
It's a seed from California, maybe. Just buy a few acres in Florida or in California and secede.
Yeah, you could go to Texas, Nevada, or possibly. I mean, Arizona's got a low tax rate, but Texas or Nevada probably.
I like it. I like it. Although it has echoes of what's the John Grisham? Is it The Firm? Yeah, it's like what happens when people want to leave. Do like bad things start happening to them if they try to leave?
But I think it's actually like I'm joking with the idea, but I think it would be possible to do, and I think you'd get enough people that would want to do it. I would, if there was something like that, I would sign up for it for sure. Yeah. Because we were thinking about places to live, and we're like, well, I mean, climate matters, of course, to some degree, but 90% of what you're going to, like the value that you're going to have and where you live is going to be your community, essentially,
right.
Like what you're doing from a daily, like within the 3-mile radius of you and the people you hang out with and the ideals that you share. And so like, if you can build that yourself, then it doesn't really matter so much where you are.
Yep. Well, that's really interesting.
So if there's someone out there that wants to fund this project.
Nice. Well, maybe if you can get in with Tony Robbins, he has an island, right? So maybe, you know, there's a possibility.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm going to that. I told you about the, I think I'm going to the EPW, the Unleash the Power Within.
Yeah. So you haven't been to one of those before, right?
No. Yeah, my wife's going to come too. We have to figure out a babysitting situation. We're probably going to we're going to fly in a relative.
Okay, cool. So, and that's in March?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I think March 7th through 10th, I believe. So.
Nice. And that's his kind of like core offering, right? Or
like that's.
Entry,
yeah, one of his
gateway main. Drug.
Exactly. Yep. So.
Well, yeah, I still need to get. I want to get one of his books. And is there a book that aligns with that pretty well, or you know?
Well, there's. I would say that the Unleash the Power Within. There's a book called Unleash the Power Within.
Okay. Well, that sounds, yeah, that sounds like a good matchup there.
I'm actually reading that one now. And then there's the Awaken the Giant Within. Okay. Or no, the book is Unlimited Power. The other book is Awaken the Giant Within. So there's Unlimited Power. Unlimited Power is probably more in line. That's his first book. And that's probably more in line with the EPW. And then Awaken the Giant Within was the, I've read that one already. And that one aligns more with the Date with Destiny seminar, I think. So,
okay. I'm going to have to look at that one. Yeah. So one thing that's interesting is I've been just kind of mentally wrestling like this whole, like I've decided that I have to do the guest posting approach to really, if I'm going to grow my traffic, because I got, I forwarded you guys the email that I got banned from Facebook this week.
Yeah. I saw it. Yeah.
That was so lame. I just can't believe it. I decided like you can, there's ways around it. Like you can open another account and, you know, just new credit card. It's like you almost have to like new credit card, new some people will get a new laptop so they have a different MAC address, new internet provider. Seriously, like at least with Google, people will like just go back, like they'll erase their whole footprint and get some, you know, start completely over, and then you don't usually get banned again immediately, at least. But yeah, it's like with Facebook, if they're going to be that twitchy about it, there's no way that I'm going to keep that account for more than a couple months. So I don't, it's not worth bothering with. I mean, it's just,
it's not a good system. It's not a sustainable system.
No.
Sustainable systems that are better for the long term are ones where you don't have to keep on adapting to the system.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And
strategy, it has to last long enough that it's
right.
Worth it. Yeah, otherwise,
exactly. I mean, otherwise it's just constantly, yeah. You're just constantly playing keep up.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of people that build businesses around things like selling $5 shirts on Facebook, which, okay, fine, but you're just going to have to keep on, like, you're going to keep on it. Like it's constantly changing. You're going to be, adapting to it all the time. You're never going to be able to build a permanent system in place. Where... Yep.
Yeah. So I've been wrestling with this, like, so I have this attitude about content marketing. I'm not a big fan of it. And I realized, so I've been thinking a lot about that. And I realized that the problem is, at least in marketing, is that, Tony Robbins talks a lot about, In the money book, Master of the Game, he talks a lot about, you know, just always having this attitude of like, how much value can I deliver?
Right.
And I think you mentioned that too. And content marketing in the marketing space is not set up to allow you to do that, or it makes it really tough. Because what everybody does is everybody's selling easy buttons and bright, shiny objects. And I hate that. like everybody is just like, if you go and look at the kind of content that most people are putting out, it's like they Googled, you know, copywriting, and they like read three articles about it and they summarized them and they published it. And it's just garbage. And so like when I've just seen so much of that I get really cynical about it. And so I've been trying to figure out like, okay, how can I work within the system, but still like put out stuff that I think is really valuable, without having to be the guy, you know, selling the easy buttons.
Well, there you go. I mean, that right there, right? Well, because what you just did right now is you just offered a huge amount of value by giving that perspective. And it's unique because only you can offer that value because it's you. You have the experience and you have seen this. And so, I mean, that would make a good blog post. That makes good content. I mean, heck, I mean, this is content programmers. That's part of the value that we provide here. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing. I think that's the piece that you're missing, to be honest.
Well, the problem is that there's another layer to it, which is that the type of stuff that I find really valuable in marketing is also not stuff that will ever get you any traffic from Google. So I have to, so basically I have to find the guest posting angle. It lets me get around that. Like my goal with guest posting is not to get ranked highly in Google for anything. It's just to get referral traffic.
Hey, what's up? John Sonmez here. Just want to take a second to thank one of the sponsors for this episode of EntreProgrammers, DigitalOcean. So I've talked about DigitalOcean a lot before on the show, and that's because they're just such an awesome company. I use them to host all of my websites, basically simpleprogrammer.com, which gets around 200,000 page views a month, runs on there super smooth. Get Up and Code runs on there. The EntreProgrammers podcast that you're listening to right now, we use DigitalOcean for that. I use it for just about everything, and it's such a good deal. You know, as far as hosting goes, right, if you're going to run your own Linux server and do your own web hosting at $5 a month, which is the starting plan for DigitalOcean, you just really can't beat that. It's crazy. And when you do need something super powerful, DigitalOcean comes through for you as well, and it's so easy to scale up to that. I started out on Simple Programmer with a $10 a month box, and I was even able with that to get 100,000 page views a month without much of a problem. But when I wanted to scale up, all I had to do was bring the server down, expand the size, go up to the higher size droplet, and bam, I was up there, and I've expanded it a couple of times since then. So DigitalOcean, definitely awesome company. I would definitely recommend that you check it out if you have any idea of creating a website online, or you want to have your own Linux server to be able to do whatever it is that you want to do, some development or put out a production app. Just a ton of great things that you can do with DigitalOcean. Go to DigitalOcean.com and use the code EntreProgrammers to get $10 credit. So DigitalOcean.com, EntreProgrammers is your code, and you get $10 credit, good for basically 2 months at a $5 box, so you can check it out. Hey, what's up? John Sonmez here. Just wanted to tell you about NIRD. You can find them at nird.us. And what NIRD is Ruby on Rails managed hosting. It's a pretty cool service because what they basically do is they can manage your entire Ruby on Rails application, do all kinds of neat stuff like configure the services that you need, do continuous deployment, DNS, and SSL management. They'll also migrate all your data from your old host. It makes it super easy to sign up with them. They update your security on your application, have the latest security patches, and then they also provide 2 hours a month of application bug fixes, so that's pretty dang awesome. Anyway, so check them out. You can go to nird.us, and when you sign up, you're going to get a referral code. You're going to basically get a $100 discount if you use this offer, so check it out. It's totally worth it, and let us know what you think of it. You can find the link there to sign up if you just go to nird.us/manage-rails-hosting. That's nird.us/manage-rails-hosting, and then just put into the contact form freelancer and you'll get that discount code. Hope you check it out and hope you enjoy it, and thanks for listening to the show. Take care.
Because like even now, like I still look at yesterday I was looking at my keyword report, and it is absolutely like it's a joke. I mean, the Google traffic that I get is an absolute joke. It's like all of my top stuff is P90X. I wrote one article about P90X one time. Trello and Standing Desk stuff, because I wrote one article about each of those, and I got some good backlinks on that stuff.
And that's on your joshuaearl.com.
Yeah. Mm-hmm, yep. And I don't rank for anything copywriting related at all. Like I'd have to, you have to play, for copywriting, I don't even know, cause there's not a lot of search traffic out there to begin with. So I don't even know what. I looked for good terms in the Google keyword tool, and there's really not a lot of search traffic out there. So, I went to entrepreneur.com, and I was like, all right, I have this negative view that I can't get the kind of content published that I want to get published. Like what I like to do is take the older, you know, the old stuff, the old principles that are unchanging, and you know, not super sexy, but you don't won't have to learn something brand new tomorrow. I like to talk about that stuff. So I went to entrepreneur.com and I said, okay, can I get published on entrepreneur.com writing about the kind of stuff that I want to write about?
Right.
And I didn't find any articles there that were exactly like what I'd be wanting to write, but I found articles that were mentioning the types, some of the types of things that I'd be wanting to write about. So I think I can actually, so I kind of cured myself of that this week. Like, I think I can actually write the type of stuff that I want to write and get it out there in these high visibility places. So I have to crack into I've been working on this week, cracking into the entrepreneur.com circle.
Yeah.
I've reached out to, so they have like a general submit a guest post idea form. Well, you know how many of those they probably get a day. Yeah, they probably get that. 20,000 a day. So I'm contacting people who have written for entrepreneur.com multiple articles and trying to get in touch with them and figure out who's your editor.
Right.
And so far it's been surprisingly difficult. I had several people just like open my emails and just ignore them. But there's one guy who I think is going to actually give me the info finally. I'm going to get in touch with an editor, and really my focus is going to be, I want to get like one or two guest posts published on entrepreneur.com. Then I'm going to start submitting syndicated posts to them once I have the relationship, because I think it would be easier for me to pitch a unique, exclusive content to them than, hey, I published this thing, would you, you know, stick it up and send me more traffic? So I think once they get used to working with me, I can come back to them later and offer to let them syndicate stuff. But I alleviated my concerns a little bit about the quality issue, just by digging into what they've actually published. And they actually have a copywriting tag that no one really owns.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay.
So yeah, they publish maybe like one or two articles a quarter on copywriting.
Yeah.
And what I want to do is the angle that I want to take with it is I want to be the guy who takes copywriting and then storytelling. And there's a lot of people who talk about storytelling and copy, but nobody really owns that topic.
Right.
There's like a couple people that have some products and stuff around it, but nobody has really stepped up and like said, I'll show you how to really use story effectively in copy. So I'm starting to study stuff like, there's a book called, Wired for Story. That's what it is. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's really good. That like basically explains a lot of the brain, you know, what goes on in your brain when it comes to understanding storytelling. So I want to take that kind of stuff and bring it into the direct response copywriting world. Because people will be like, oh, just, you know, the best way to engage people in your copy is to tell a story, but then nobody actually...
They don't tell you how. Yeah,
there's no, like, there's nothing beyond that. They might show you an example, but they don't really show you, like, you know, how... Like, this week I had a student submit an email that he'd written, and he opened it with a story, and it was... The email overall was pretty good, but the story initially didn't work because it was too unfocused. And so I'm working on a blog post now about what happened, like how your brain processes a story and what causes you to get confused. So it's really interesting. Like, it's, to me, it's really interesting stuff. And I think people will really like it. I just need to be able to, it's not something that you're ever going to get Google traffic for. And so I really need a good way to distribute it, or I'll just be wasting my time.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, it's the same thing that we're kind of discovering with Simple Programmer too, is right. It's like, it's a similar, you're not going to get Google traffic on the kind of soft skills articles because people are not searching for, how can I get along with my boss as a software developer or something like that.
Right.
You
know? Yeah.
So you kind of need, I don't know, but as you build a reputation and people come
to you and hear about you, and you have enough of these articles out there that people do search on, then they'll find. So it's almost like you need like those few like ones that are,
yeah, you
know, that are pulling in traffic, and then when people get to your site, you know, it's the whole bait. It's not bait and switch, but it's like you give them what they want, and then they
sell them what they want again, give them what they need.
Exactly. Yep. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. For me, that's tricky because like I was trying to wrap my brain around that, how to do that for email marketing. And basically if you search anything email marketing related, it's like, it's like MailChimp. It's like, you know, how to connect your form to your web form to your mail provider, that type of stuff is what you get. And it's really tough. I mean, you get some people searching for like subject line stuff, but you know, beyond that, there's not really a lot of anybody looking for anything about email marketing, like email. It's like email templates, email. It's like technical how-to stuff. And then, that's pretty much it. And then maybe like some subject lines and stuff.
Did you see the Vibrant Glenn Alsop's latest post?
No, I did not.
He did one about, you should read it.
Okay.
So
I quit reading. I like his stuff was always really good, but it was just so freaking long.
Yeah. his latest one, I didn't read the entire post, but I was scanning.
If you type Viper Chill into Google, you get Viper Chill scam.
Oh, that's
one
great
of the suggestions.
Anyway, the thing he was talking about, 6,595 words on traffic generation tactic you're not using but should be, and essentially what this is. Oh, that's weird. Okay.
Can you send me a link? Because I can't. I'm going to his blog, and it's just like I'm getting some kind of weird landing page.
Okay. So essentially what this is basically he's saying using.
Oh, here it is. I got it. Sorry. Oh,
okay. Yeah. Using tools to.
Yeah.
This like indirect, site. So this could kind of like serve you in the way. So for example, just throwing this one out here, let's say that you created a site that was all about like using MailChimp.
Right,
like fixing problems in MailChimp, right? You know, all the kinds of issues, you know, MailChimp related, and then that was actually feeding your copywriting email because the people that are using MailChimp, they don't know it, but they have a problem which you could do for them, which is to do copywriting or to teach them, either one, you know.
Right,
they either could have someone do the email copywriting for them or you could teach them.
Yeah.
And so if you had a bunch of sites like that fed into your main blog, then
I should think about something like that. I've thought about trying to, the problem is then you have two problems, right? Or more, because you have to be an expert on the technical side of it as well as the content side of it. I've thought about doing something like that with Drip, but I'm not sure if that would get me enough juice to be worth it. Because I could actually do that because I wouldn't have to go and learn it from scratch. Like, I'm not going to learn Infusionsoft, you know.
Right. Exactly.
But it's a good idea. It would be nice to. I mean, kind of that's what Pat Flynn has done too. Like, he's got a lot of really. Yeah. Detailed, and that is what you need to get search traffic. You need the detailed how-to about something very specific that people are going to Google, and tools are pretty much it. So, but yeah, for me, this week I've been like unwinding. I spend about half an hour in the morning just free writing with a notepad and pencil, and I've been kind of unwinding some of that, like, because I've hit up against this thing where I just was having a really, I'm going to start guest blogging. Why is this so hard? Like, why can't I make myself do this? And like, I'll get started on something and then I'll be like, I keep hitting this wall And so I just kind of spent, I took a step back and spent some time trying to unwind it. And I realized that, like what I was saying, like I feel like I was feeling like I was trying to go against some core beliefs that I have. And it was just, I was stripping gears.
Yeah. No, so, I think there, that's a, it's going to require a combination of things. Well, here's the other thing, like that, like there's sort of an intangible value that's hard to describe, and you can't really strategize a way to do this. But if you build up a reputation and a name, then it works no matter what, right? Mm-hmm. It's like there's, you're going to have value from that no matter what. And so
yeah,
part of that is going to have to be creating content.
Yeah.
Create the value, right? So that's
right.
Yeah. That's, yeah, that's, I mean, that's, and that's part of what works with Simple Programmer as well.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it takes a long, it's taken some time to do that, but yeah, no, it's a tough problem to solve for sure. Especially if you don't have a very specific topic.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm still kind of feeling my way through that. Actually, it's actually been, a lot of what's been feeding this has been me reading through, going through your whole course,
yeah.
How to Market Yourself course. Cause yeah, I definitely don't have, you know, I'm still kind of banging around trying to figure out like what is my place in this whole marketing world. Cause it's a pretty crowded niche, and I'm still trying to figure out like what exactly really appeals to me about it and where I want to plant my flag.
Yeah, I do like what you're saying about the storytelling aspect,
yeah,
because I think you could easily take that space and be, and not only would your, you know, potential clients and customers, I mean, you could teach copywriters how to do
yeah.
this, and mm-hmm. advanced copywriters, and they would pay for it.
Yep.
I mean, I think, you know, this is just my thought, is that if you had a course that you were selling on doing story writing, I think even some of your famous copywriter friends would buy it,
mm-hmm.
simply because they know you have something to teach on that they don't know.
Yeah. Well, yeah, kind of the way I'm thinking about it is I really like, I was thinking about all the people that I really admire, and all of them have take stuff from outside of business and marketing and make it relevant. So like, you know, Perry Marshall's latest thing is this, he spent the last 12 years studying biology and evolution, and he brings a bunch of those concepts into marketing in a way that's completely unique and just really fascinating. And so I kind of want to be like be somebody who cross pollinates like that.
Yeah.
And the storytelling thing, like there's a lot of, I also really like Derick Halpern, and his angle is, you know, he's taking this psychological research and bringing it into marketing. I'd like to be somebody like that. I'd like my thing to be like some kind of Venn diagram between two different disciplines that are related, but no one's really done a good job of bringing them together yet. And I think that the storytelling thing is cool too, because it actually lets me cross over out of the direct response copywriting world, which I like, and also pick up people on the content marketing side, because
exactly, yeah,
I really see like the biggest problem with most content is that it has no soul. You know, like it's just really dry. It's information, and actually, you know, the robots are going to take those jobs. They've already got AI software that will write factual Wikipedia style articles, just spider the web and pull stuff together. And we've all probably read stuff that was written that way and we didn't realize it. News organizations are using it now. So if it's just pure factual information, you're going to be out of a job. and information is such a commodity now. Like it's not valuable. Like insight and wisdom and story are what's valuable now.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So no, I mean, I think that might be an angle if you just specialized in that. Plus you'd have, I think also you'd have a good promotion. You know, if you can bill yourself as the story guy that helps people put stories together, mm-hmm. I think that you'd be able to guest post with, I think a lot of copywriters that you know would share your stuff mm-hmm. with their audience because it's a value that you're providing that they aren't looking to specialize in.
Yeah.
And you could be known as that, you know, for that particular thing. So
yeah, and that's really what got me excited about copywriting in the first place was I wanted to be a magazine feature writer. I wanted to write for the New Yorker. I freaking love their epic 20 page, you know, 20,000, they're like novella length stories. They're like mini books and these guys will spend 6 months. I don't know how you eat if you do this, but they'll spend 6 months researching one story. And, you know, they'll like go live with people, you know, and actually get into their lives and see how they live and everything. And I love that kind of depth and richness, and that being able to do some of that was what attracted me into copywriting in the first place.
Yeah.
So you know, that's like a very natural for me to try to bring those together is very natural.
Yes. Yeah, I think really that makes sense. So let me ask you, so this is,
okay.
It sounds like, like what's your direction as far as what you're trying to do this year? Cause, I'm starting to think, I'm wondering like now, do you still want to go the simple programmer direction?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No. Yeah. No, basically this year, I mean, I just want to build my audience and I'm honestly not thinking about, I'm not going to worry about creating products or anything for a while. I want to build my audience and build traffic and just kind of build a reputation. And it's going to take a while because I think this topic is not really something that it's not something I'm going to get Google traffic for, especially not overnight. So, you know, so that's kind of like my goal is to really just, I want to just build my email list this year. And that's pretty much it. Like I'm not really even focusing. I'm not even really planning on doing any kind of products or anything like that.
Okay. Yeah. So, I don't want to like every time I hear you talking about this, I'm thinking, I don't want to like prevent you from doing the thing that you want to.
No. And I think, I think that working on Simple Programmer is perfect for this because it's like a laboratory.
Exactly.
Yeah. You know, and we're gonna we're gonna be basically applying all this stuff that I'm thinking and reading and studying about, and so.
Yeah, it'll be a case.
I don't think there's any. I'm not in any way like tempted to go off the reservation or anything.
Okay. So, just checking. Like I said. I want to make sure I'm not keeping you.
For me, this is like I've been thinking about like what do I want my business to look like in 5 years. And this is the type of thing that I think is going to be long-term is going to be valuable because I do think that like the whole AI thing, I really think that a lot of people are going to be very surprised at what happens to their jobs as things get more and more automated. And really the last refuge is to be an artist.
Yep.
And so that this kind of fits into that. And it'll be relevant, like no matter what the technology, no matter what happens in technology, you know, 5 years from now, something's going to replace email someday. I don't know when. So I want to be not tied to a technology.
Exactly. Yeah.
And this is something you can take these principles and do them on Facebook and, you know, do them on email. It's very, cross technological. You can do the same stuff in video. I mean, it's all relevant.
Oh yeah. There's a huge value in that, in the whole storytelling aspect. That's one of the things like I've been trying to incorporate, like as I read your emails and stuff, I'm like, oh, the story that's like the, and I've been trying to figure out how to do it. And I know that like I need to start doing it for my YouTube videos too. Mm-hmm. And I'm not really doing it. And then when I do, I'm like, oh shoot, I just spent 10 minutes telling a story. Now I don't have time to elaborate. Yeah. And so it's like, I've got to be able to make the story concise enough to the point, and then to have the hook that flows nicely into the point that's being made.
Mm-hmm.
And when you look at like, the other thing is like, as it, what it really hit me when I was at that date with Destiny seminar with Tony Robbins, because I mean, he's standing up there talking for like 10 hours at a time, perhaps, right? And some mm-hmm. stretches, and no one's falling asleep.
Right.
Right. I mean, part of it right. is because you're jumping around and the room's cold, but a large part of it is because he's telling stories, like yes. just story after story, and yep. he gets into the point. But you like, it's hardwired in your brain to focus and to find things yep. interesting when they're presented in that format, even though it seems like that wouldn't work. But
yeah,
it works every time. Like even yep. the stupidest story, mm-hmm. if I tell you a story about like what my day was like and what I had for lunch, so I do it in the right way. Like it's interesting. You want to yep. know what's going to happen, and right.
Yep. So, yeah. The blog post that I'm working on right now is actually kind of about that. So one of the principles from this Wired for Story book is that the theme of the story, like people think what happens, like the plot of the story, is what's important or what makes it interesting, but it's actually the theme of the story, like the meaning and how it affects the people in the story, that is what really makes it interesting.
Yeah.
And because you can take the same exact plot points and tell them different ways, and it can be a complete yawner, or yeah. it can be really, really fascinating. She has an example of from a book where this woman is like getting her teeth cleaned at the dentist, and yeah. she's sitting in the dental chair and she starts crying. Well, that sounds kind of, you know, boring, but then the way that the author it turns out, this woman was like, you know, she was in, I think, an abusive relationship, and she hadn't been touched in a, you know, a friendly way in years. And so like the yeah. dentist touching her cheek, just like to her, it was like this gentle caress, and it just brought her to tears. And like, you know, that like the same details, same exact details, just the way that you, you know, the point of it is what actually makes it interesting.
Right. Exactly. Yeah.
So I had I had a student submit an email, and he starts off talking about how he went home for the holidays. And the problem was that a third of the way into the email, he told you all this detail, but you didn't know where he was going with it. And so my brain was like, my brain literally went in three different directions. I was like, as I was reading it, I was like, okay, here's what this means. No, here's what this means. No, here's what this means. And like your brain just sorts short circuits and you stop reading.
Right.
So you have to, like, from the very first word, you have to be showing them that you're heading in a specific direction.
Exactly. And, like, yeah.
Showing them that there's actual meaning to this story, you know, just wait for it and it'll be there.
Yeah.
So yeah, this kind of stuff really gets me fired up.
Yeah. No, this is, tell, I mean, but, this is seriously, like, because I've realized that I need to learn how to do this properly. Mm-hmm. I'm learning. I'm not good at it right now. I'm getting better, but I mean, and it's just surprising. Like, even, I don't know, did I talk about this last time? I did a YouTube video on, like, I did one on how I got fired from my first job type of.
Yeah.
Then I did a follow up where I told my story about moving to different places in my next, because some people were asking for, and that was like one of the most popular, most commented videos on my YouTube channel. And I had asked people if they wanted more, and they're like all these people commented and said, yes, yes, I want to know what happens next.
Right.
And I was thinking, this, when I did the video, I just did it because someone had asked. Like, I thought, okay, this isn't really going to be very popular. Most people aren't even going to care about this. I'm just telling about my job and, you know, the jobs I had in career. And now people want the next episode of that. And so that's, so that made me realize, like, wow, that's interesting. Yeah. People really, really dig stories, even if they're not done well.
Yeah, one of the first couple of chapters of Wired for Story talks about how basically your brain is always trying to process everything into a story.
Yeah.
That's how we make sense of data. Otherwise, it's just noise. Yeah. And she uses the example of, like, the wrestling, you know, you're, you know, caveman with your spear, and there's a wrestling in the bushes. Well, you have this story that the last guy that heard the rustling in the bushes got eaten by a tiger.
Right.
You know? Yep. And so, and if you can't fit the pieces together into some kind of coherent story, then you just decide it's noise and you throw it out and you stop paying attention. So yeah, this stuff is really interesting. So
It's amazing too, like your memory capacity. Like if I tell you a story, like you can remember like the details of that story without even trying. Like you could repeat that back, you know, maybe not exact, but if I gave you the same number of facts, like just without a story, like it'd just be impossible. You wouldn't, but stories, like you can remember some story that's told you, like so much information because your brain is wired for that.
Yep. Cool. So, yeah. So that's pretty much what I've been up to. I need to get into a habit where I'm publishing at least one blog post a week. Yep. And I'd like to work that up to two, but I'm just going to start with one. And this week I didn't do it, but I did start. I'm warming up the engine. I need to just commit and pull the trigger and actually do it. But I did. I set a daily goal for myself. I actually realized that my daily writing goal was a little bit too ambitious, so I've cut it back to 800 words a day. So that's 500 words in an email and then 300 words in a blog post.
Yep.
And if I do that 5 days a week, that's plenty to publish a blog post every week. And then I'm going to start to bump that up like every day or every month. I'm going to add 100 words to my quota.
Yep.
Just, you know, until I'm writing a few thousand words a day. So
that's a good idea. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I've been kind of like a little bit of this has been figuring out like, okay, what outlets am I going to, where am I going to be publishing these things and who am I targeting? So I'm going to try to pick 3 to 5 sites initially and try to crack each one of them and at least become a regular on one of them.
Yeah. Yep.
So, cool.
Yep. So, this week I've been stressing out, but I think it's partially unnecessary. I mean, part of it is because I can't do a lot while I'm here. Like, so I kind of just, I'm just catching up with, and just trying to keep things going, which I guess is fine. And then I had one day where I had like 4 or 5 refund requests come in, which is,
oof.
And it was just like, that's just like a kick in the nuts.
Yeah.
Especially when people send you like lame excuses why they want a refund. Like, you know, I don't know. But so I just process them. And then,
yeah, you should have, that would be something that would be really good to have someone else take care of for that very reason.
Oh yeah.
Because
yeah, I guess so.
a lot of entrepreneurs will outsource that because otherwise you can get caught up. Like it'll just completely destroy your day. Like somebody gives you a crappy reason or they, you know, they feel like they have to just rant about how crappy the product was or something. And then, you know, you're toast for the rest of the day. You're thinking about it.
Yeah. I'm kind of mixed on that because at one point, you know, partially like it's good to be tough. being tougher and there's some opportunities in those also, like to be tough and objective so that you can like, you know, get the feedback, but on the other hand you're right, sometimes it'll trash your day. So I don't know.
Be to have it compiled in a monthly report for you.
Oh yeah,
I think knowing the numbers and then seeing like if there's any real tangible themes or, you know, any like meaningful feedback, that would all be good. But if somebody just like feels like they have to, you know, go on and on about it just because they feel a little guilty about doing the refund, then
yeah,
you don't need to see that.
But it didn't turn out to be as bad. I mean, there a bunch of sales ended up coming in too. So I think like for DPD sales, like for Simple Programmer, we're sitting at about 4K, a little over 4K.
Nice. Nice.
Which is fine because we're on the 15th, so
right.
we should be tracking to hit 8K, which should be pretty good. I just been the expenses are. I want to make sure that we're. I mean, we're probably going to go into the hole a little bit for the next because I'm thinking like the big expenses is 6K, and then editors 1500, so that's 7500, and then Andrew's 1000, so that's 8,500, and then the YouTube editing and stuff is probably another, you know, 500 to 700. So it adds up there. Like we need to be pulling about like 10K a month at least to break even.
Right.
Which, you know, we'll see. But that's why I think once we get, I'll feel a lot better once we get the how to market yourself page, because that'll give us like a, I'm guessing that that should at least, well, we said a minimum of like a 2K bump, because then at that point, that should give us enough buffer.
Yeah.
Because I don't really need to, I don't really need to pull money from Simple Programmer. I just want to make sure it's not bleeding.
Yeah. Money. Yep.
So I think we'll be all right. But I don't know. I shouldn't even stress about it. It's not like it's a big deal. It's just, I stress about stupid stuff. So I need to learn to like let go and not be in control. Because it's, even if I look at it from like a 6 month perspective, like we're not going to bleed like a lot of money. Even if we bled like a couple grand a month for 6 months,
yeah,
it's not a huge, you know, like it's an investment. So
right.
I guess it's also, it's just also been compiling with the editor. Like the, I feel like the content on Simple Programmer wasn't as quite as quality. But I did have a talk with. Yeah. With Elisa on that, and so I think we're going to reduce it down. We said to 2 blog posts a week, so that she can have the quality bar be a bit okay. higher on that. So
right,
and then I talked to her about getting technical content in there. So
do we want to have any kind of like? Would it be nice to have a bit of a review process for like a few weeks to like kind of. Dip your toe in the water a little bit better and get a sense for what is coming and, you know, kind of what's flowing through the system and then just give her free rein again.
Well, I've got the Trello board. Like, I think I invited you to it so we can see the editorial calendar and we can see what's coming up.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe I'll try to keep an eye on that.
Yeah. If you see things that you think are flag, I kind of take a look at it every once in a while. I try to keep my head in the sand to some degree because I don't want to like
micromanage it.
And also like, you know, there's a good chance that someone's going to write something that I'm not going to agree with. And then, but, you know, and it's hard because it's my baby. So I can't be as objective as I'd like to be about it. Like,
right. You know
what I mean? And
I don't have access to that. I don't think.
Oh, let me see. I thought I added you, but.
I don't see it in my list of boards anyway.
Add members, Josh. Josh. You are using your Josh Earl.
Josh Earl.com,
right? Okay.
Yep. Let me
see. Okay. I just did add. Made normal user on the board.
I think with that, like, I mean, would it help to give her, does she have like content that you've looked at that you say, okay, this meets my standards? And like, because I think it might be useful to look to give her some examples of the level that you want. You know, what's acceptable and what's not.
She knows it, like,
okay.
And she said that some of the content slip, but.
Do you think that she'll be able to do the technical, she'll be able to judge on the technical stuff?
I don't know. Let's see when the technical stuff comes in. I'm asking for one technical out of every 2 weeks.
Okay.
So that's a good place to start, I think, in that.
Okay. And those are more, I imagine, longer, like.
Yeah.
Like, because to me, what I'm thinking of is the site point technical stuff. That stuff seems to be killer.
Exactly. So, and at some point I was thinking, we had talked about, I mean, as our budget goes up a little bit, I think we might want to be able to offer a stipend for, like, if you write a 5,000-word technical article, we'll pay you $100 or whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's not a huge amount.
Pay you 0.05 cents per word.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. Yeah, because I think, and actually going back to our content marketing discussion too, like, one of the reasons we've had this discussion so many times is that in the technical programmer space, there isn't a lot of garbage content being created. You can't create garbage content of the kind that I you know, turns my stomach, like you can in marketing. Like, you can just, people just seriously just crank out, you know, 1,000-word empty calorie 1,000-word blog posts. And that just doesn't happen when you're writing about code or really anything technical.
Yeah. And I mean, you can do it a little bit, like there's a
little
some
bit
jump,
yeah.
But yeah, but it's not to the same degree.
Yeah.
So I don't know. We'll see. But I think if we get a few more technical type of articles in there, then that will help to get some longer tail traffic.
Yeah.
And I'm actually seeing traffic starting to bump up now. Elisa did make a good point. She said, you know, the traffic on Simple Programmer has maintained even though you've stopped blogging.
Right.
And she said you should have had a big drop off because of the people that were, because you changed it, because, you know, people that were following you and just reading your stuff, and then now you have all these other people contributing. So since that didn't drop off, that's probably because the added content actually grew. And so now we should see it rising above the water, essentially.
I could see that to some extent. But I think, like, a lot of, you're also still distributing through all of your channels. So, you know, especially the social stuff. I'd have to look at the analytics, but I bet a lot of it is social. Because if you look at it, it's like most of the, it's similar to what I saw at SitePoint, which is like the new content always gets a certain number of views, almost no matter what.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you promote it via your social channels. And then where the growth comes from long-term is obviously search traffic.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so we need to see that start to grow long-term.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's just going to, if we don't get much of anything in search, then it's just going to continue to, you know, bump along. And
one thing I'd like to do is to do probably some keyword research and to put some article ideas out there, like to make this list that people could select from that, you know, write an article on this.
Yep. Topic. You know, might be worth, do you remember Hittail?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Rob's old tool that he sold. It might be worth signing up for that for a month or two and seeing if any ideas come out of that, because the whole idea of that was that they'll look at what you're already, look at the search traffic that you're getting and look for things that if you optimize for that keyword, you'd skyrocket.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah,
or if you, like I did, I had a thing with my standing desk site where I was getting a ton of searches for, like basically best standing desk shoes or something like that. Shoes for standing desk. And so I had my copy editor or my content person at the time write an article on that, and boom, it was like, I saw this nice spike in traffic from it almost immediately. So.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. Okay. Yeah, it's definitely one of my lists of things to do is to like do some research and get some good stuff.
Yeah, well, we could even, there might even be some stuff we could do with individual blog posts where if there's something that you know is a close match, you could go in and do the Yoast SEO stuff and put together a different title and description for the search engines.
That's a good point. Yeah.
And then, you know, because I find that like a lot of times what this, like writing for social, you know, for people actually to read versus writing for the search engines, it's really hard to do both.
Yeah.
But you can, with the Yoast plugin, you can, I don't know where they put this on the page in the HTML, but you can present a different snippet for Google to see versus what people see. You know, like if somebody retweets it, it'll have a different title.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Yeah. That's definitely worth looking into. But yeah, just been stressing about that kind of stuff. Like my YouTube videos haven't been as good last week. It's weird too. Like I haven't had like this space to record, which you would think it'd be weird. Since I'm recording it for the public, but I'd need to have like space, private space where no one can hear me to actually do the recording for some reason.
Yeah.
I'll have to work on that.
I'm that way when I talk on the phone.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't like people to be in the room with me when I'm talking on the phone. Like, it just weirds me out.
But yeah, so I'm kind of excited to get back into the real swing of things. Once I get back, I'm going to really be hitting it hard trying to get stuff figured out and going. But I'm definitely thinking now that for sure once you get the how to market yourself like sales page up, that we probably need to shift to getting the advertising.
Yeah.
Because that'll be a quick, you know, because I think we can get a quick 5K up there. And then that was enough breathing room where it won't be a problem. So it's, the faster we can get to that point, the better things are going to be. So,
yep.
But, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like our, I checked the 10 steps split test, and it looks like the original is opening up a lead again. So we'll see. It's like,
yeah,
basically the buy button clicks are pretty much right at the 30% mark, which is like the break even. So it will be interesting to see if the sales eventually settle into that same rate. It would kind of be logical. I mean, like, we've raised the price essentially we raised the price 50%, but it's kind of like it's a 30% discount, like $97 versus $147 is a 30% discount. So it'd be interesting if it was like we had 30% less sales and 30% fewer buy button clicks, you know, at the one third more price.
So here's what we're looking at so far, just looking at this month.
Okay. So these are actual numbers, not the,
yeah,
the conversions. So
for actual numbers, we have a total of $588 at the $147 price.
Okay.
And at the $97 price, we have a total of $1,261.
Okay. So what are the, can you give me the counts? Like, what are the?
13 versus 4, I think.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
So it's really pushing towards the $97 price.
Yeah.
Now.
Wow. 13 yeah. versus 4.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. Well,
last month it wasn't, right? It was the other.
Oh yeah, can you? Oh yeah, can you look at all time or?
Well,
so when did I start this? I started the test. Yeah, it's been December 22nd.
Okay, December 22nd.
December 22nd. Yeah.
We've got for 97. We've got $2,037.
I just want the actual numbers. The 21
versus 8.
Oh boy. Okay. Well, I don't know what is up with the tracking in the Optimizely test then, because it is off. Wait.
Oh, I'm including January in that too.
Yeah, so yeah. That's total, right?
It's from that. Yeah. The total.
And are you sure that 21 is only since we started the test on the 22nd?
Yep.
Okay. Well, that's not even close then. I think we should probably end it.
And just stick with the 97.
Yeah. So that's like what, like 38% of the sales are going toward the, I don't know what I'm trying to calculate.
All we got to do is look at the dollars, really.
Yeah, that's true. Yep.
Because if you look at it for 147, we're at $1,176.
Mm-hmm.
And for 97, we're at $2,037.
All right. So you want to call it?
I'm tempted to let it run to the end of the month, but.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't really.
It sucks that Optimizely isn't giving us good data. We have to figure out.
Yeah, I think that's probably Drip's or DPD's fault.
Yeah.
Because that conversion, the way I have it set up is there's conversion tracking code that's only supposed to show one time on the cart checkout page. And obviously that's not happening because it's reporting 11 sales at 147 and only 15. That's really strange. It's underreporting the original and overreporting the other.
Underreporting the original and over.
Yeah. It's underreporting the 97 and overreporting. Maybe, you know what, maybe it's, let me see what's the, so 20, what's 21 plus 8, 29. No, it's 26. It's only reporting 26 sales.
I don't know how you set it up. How did you set it up so that it only, so the 147?
There's a section on, I thought that there was a place in DPD that said only show this once. like there is. Checkout code, basically the checkout code.
But areas. There's not going to be a different checkout code for 147 versus 97.
No, what I did was with the goal was I just set up the, but DPD knows because they're optimizing knows because it cookies people. So when you hit the page at 147, you get a cookie. And then when you see the checkout page, it knows, okay, he was on the 147 page.
Hmm.
That's how it's supposed to work.
Oh, I don't know. I guess we could look at that if we set this up again.
Because all I'm doing is I'm looking for my conversion goal is like a URL match on the URL of the checkout page.
Oh, well then that's why it's going to fire multiple times.
No, it's a URL match on the order fulfillment page rather.
Yeah.
The download page. Yeah, okay. It's possible I have it wrong, but I don't think if it was wrong, I think we'd be seeing a lot more conversions than we are. Like I could see me getting it wrong, but it would be a lot worse, I think, than what we're seeing.
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, there's definitely something that's messed up. Maybe we can test that out and see. Oh, yeah. Here's another thing I wanted to run by you.
Okay.
Also. So I'm seeing we're getting a lot of the blogging workbook sales.
Okay.
But I think I've only had one sale so far using the code that gives you an additional $10 off in the blogging workbook.
Okay.
So what that tells me is that, well, I mean, it doesn't say it for sure, but I suspect that if you buy the blogging workbook, it's actually hurting our sales for the How to Market Yourself course.
So you're saying you've only seen one sale for the code that people would get for How to Market Yourself at the end of the blogging course.
Exactly.
So
I have a couple of theories of why it might be. I mean, the one of the theories is that it accelerates the process. Like you download the blogging workbook and maybe you start ignoring the emails and you just like, so you don't get you ignore the content that's being dripped out to you and then the sale at the end.
How many people are
another one is it gets rid of urgency to some degree. So
How many people are downloading it?
The blogging workbook?
Yeah.
We're getting a lot of sales of that. So let me go to the store that has it. Okay. So the blogging course workbook, there's been 174 purchases total so far, or let me see. Let's just look at January. So for January, we've had, why is it not showing up in there? Oh, I've got 2017. For January, we've had 41 purchases.
Okay.
So that's a lot. Total dollar value of $205.
Are you able to go back to when you first made that available and like, I think that would be the way to do it would be to compare How to Market Yourself maybe 3 months prior.
It's hard because there were sales in November, right? The Black Friday sales. Yeah. So.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I don't know how to measure that other than take it out or find a way to A/B test it or something.
Because
we can't like, if we could A/B test the content and drip, we could probably hack something together with the A/B testing or hack something together where we assign, like Infusionsoft lets you assign people to just have to put tags on them. And then you can say, send this to tag A and send this to tag B. We might be able to do that with, you might be able to do something like that with the new workflow stuff in drip.
Okay, and then have some of them be given the offer for the blogging workbook and some of them not. And then it's hard because the blogging course takes 3 weeks to get
I know.
To the end of two. So
it's tempting to just say, why don't we take it out and just see what happens?
Because it doesn't generate a lot of extra revenue, right? Well, here's what I know. Okay, actually, so it almost seems like the answer is to take it out because
Okay, so for January, like, we might end up selling $300 worth of the blogging workbook.
I see where this is going.
Right.
If it takes away one sale.
Yeah, effectively. And it's not adding one sale, because I'm not seeing anyone using that discount code. And why would you not use that discount code? It's $10 cheaper than the other discount code.
Right. Yeah, so I mean.
Yeah, so if it takes away one sale, then we're, you know.
That has links in it, right? That book?
Yeah.
One thing interesting that you could do would be to put some UTM parameters on those links and see if anybody's actually using the thing.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Because you could, you know, if you're getting, I suspect that people buy it and never open it. Probably 80 to 90% of people never open it.
I don't know, because people do the blogging course via email
It comes to them in their email, and they see it every time they have a new lesson.
And they still get the emails. So, right. I don't know. That'd be interesting to.
Yeah, but that's the only thing I could think of, would be to try to measure the engagement on the PDF. If 80% of people seem to be using it, then yeah, I think that there's a chance that it could hurt sales.
Let me try putting a search on the HCM customer and blogging. Oh, wait. Shoot, this tag thing doesn't work so good. I'll just add another tag. Include blogging course workbook. So eight subscribers have both. But one of them's me. So seven. And one of them used the code, I think.
Okay.
So a few didn't use the code.
Mm-hmm.
So
one thing also, too, is that drip is, well, I guess this is not true for you, but the drip, no. I found the drip code underreports the number of people. When I did my giveaway or my sale with Wes, it only reported, I only got about half of the people marked in drip as being buyers.
I've got that code working pretty good with drip. So
it's a chance that, I mean, it could just be the vagaries of internet, you know, of JavaScript calls and people buying on mobile or something. And
well, I add them from their PayPal account or from their after the purchase.
Yeah, if you're doing like a CSV.
Yeah, so I might actually have, well, no, as part of, I'm using the Drip API to do it. So if you make a purchase, you get added to the email.
Is it through DPD or is it through the Drip conversion tracking JavaScript that shows at checkout?
It's the checkout JavaScript.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just saying that I use your JavaScript.
Yeah.
And it underreported the number of sales by about half. So I don't know. I don't know. It's possible that I made, you know, changed it and broke it somehow. But yeah, so there's a chance that you might want to like do a manual export of your customers out of DPD and then import them and tag everybody and see what happens.
Okay. Yeah, that might be worth taking a look at. But I mean, I am not seeing the code being used, so it's it's something that maybe we could look at some point and see if we can figure out how to, because the other thing is, like, it's, you know, the pricing on the workbook, or also can we use it as a better lead magnet? Maybe I should take the offer out of there, or I don't know. There, it seems like there'd be some way. I think also the workbook works. The intent was originally just to use as a lead magnet to be able to pull people in to pay for paid advertising or, you know, to some degree.
Yeah.
And then I thought, well, I might as well sell it to the people that are already subscribing. So.
Yeah, I think, I mean, the blogging course itself as an email course seems to work really well.
Yeah. So maybe, okay. I'll, maybe it's worth it having a longer discussion and determining whether or not we should just yank this.
Yeah. It might not hurt to just yank it for a month.
Yeah, and see
because,
if
it's still. Well, yeah, because and actually doing it now would make sense because we're going to be doing this new sales page and then all bets are off as far as data. You know, everything's going to change at that point, so.
That's true. Okay. I've got to be able to pull it out of a lot of places, though, in order to do that. So,
is it in the emails, all throughout the emails?
And we won't see the effects for 3 weeks. Yeah, it is. And we won't see the effects for 3 weeks.
Yeah. All right. Well, yeah, we can talk more about it later. Maybe it might be a good idea to just simplify. We can take a look at that whole email sequence and see, do we want to like chop it down or streamline it in some way to try to give us a more, you know, more focused funnel into the course or something.
Yeah, that's true. You know, what we could also do is offer the blogging workbook after the course if you didn't buy the How to Market Yourself.
As a downsell. I like that.
Yeah, as a downsell, or even just like a couple of weeks after, as a follow up, like to now, you know, refresher on the blogging course. You know, there's a lot of people want to retake the blogging course,
and so
the workbook, and then now they've got a chance to actually buy the.
Okay. Yeah, I like that.
So I don't know. Well, I guess we can look at that. I guess one thing too, like now that I'm thinking about, the clearest thing to do would be to look at the conversion rate of people who sign up for the email course and buy How to Market Yourself versus the conversion rate of people who buy the workbook and buy How to Market Yourself.
Yes.
And if the workbook is not higher or if it's lower, and we've got enough data points, then we don't want to offer the workbook.
Yeah. Yep. So, that sounds reasonable.
I guess we should probably wrap it up here.
Yeah.
Thoughts for the week, for the day?
I don't know. For me, I think the theme of this week has been this, like, try to be like, if there's something you really want to do and you feel like the only way to make it happen is to be inauthentic, then re-examine your assumptions and see if you can find a way to get there that allows you to not feel yucky. I guess.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Not very well stated, but
Let's see. Mine has been probably, I guess I would say, and I did a video on this one, is sometimes you need to just hold the line as opposed to, like, you know, the more important skill. You can't always push the ball forward, but if you can keep it from rolling back down the hill sometimes, that's like, as long as you have that skill, then you know, even if you're only able to inch it forward sometimes, then that's fine. But the problem is not the real problem is not being able to hold the line. Like, you have to be able to hold the line. Like, you're going to gain some yards, and then you got to keep those yards you gained. And so
that's a big theme in like a lot of the investment stuff that I've been reading lately. Don't lose money.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. So like this week I wasn't feeling like working out, like lifting and all kinds of things. Like, and so I was like, okay, well, can I just hold the line as much as I can? And then when I have the energy again, then I can push forward. So that's what I've been trying to focus on, is just like, don't, because a lot of people go off the rails. And then, I mean, you screw up when you make those decisions, and that's like, you can destroy an entire, you know, a large, it's much faster to destroy things than it is to build them. So you have to protect what you build.
Yep.
So there it is.
Awesome. All right. Alrighty.
So next week, try to think. So we're, so we've got a couple more weeks, and then
Then we'll be...
you're coming down for the conversion.
Yep.
All right.
Alrighty.
All right. Take care.
See ya.
Bye.
Want to start a business, but you just know how to code. Listen to